So we have been discussing iterative methods for solving linear algebraic equations, and then after discussing algorithms, we started looking at convergence of these methods. We also derived necessary and sufficient condition for convergence. Necessary and sufficient condition for convergence was spectral radius of matrix S inverse T should be inside unit circle. And we said that, well, it definitely gives us a lot of insight into what happens, but we need something even simpler to calculate. And we have started looking at matrix norms to come up with something that is easier to compute in terms of assessing whether a matrix, whether a matrix, which you use to formulate the iterations, you can apply some quick test to come up with convergence analysis. So induced matrix norm was defined as norm of A. Let's talk about norm in which the norm induced by identical norm on both range and domain space. So this is max x not equal to 0, norm ax by norm x. And the way I tried to explain this was, this is something like amplification power of a matrix. Other way of writing the same thing, so it is two norm here and two norm. If I want one norm, it will be A one norm, one norm, and one norm, and so on. This is called induced norm because this is induced by the norm defined on the range and the domain space. Okay, that's why it's called induced norm. Other way of writing this is a generic thing, so I could actually, I need not write two, but we were discussing two norm at the end of the last class. So this inequality can also be written like this, norm AX divided by norm x is less than or equal to. So norm A is in some sense a bound, upper bound on this ratio. Of course, this is always greater than 0. For x is not equal to 0, this is always greater than 0. Okay? Or it could be always greater than or equal to 0. Suppose A is a matrix which is rank deficient and AX is in the null space, then AX will be 0. But denominator is not 0. So this can be greater than or equal to 0. And this is an upper bound. Norm is an upper bound. Maximum of this ratio, or maximum of the gain, maximum of the amplifying power of the matrix, whatever way you want to view it. Okay. Now, in particular, we started discussing two norm. So in two norm, I just started by putting AX2 square divided by x2 square, which I wrote as x transpose A transpose AX divided by x transpose X. I can do all these divisions because this is a scalar. X transpose A transpose A times X is a scalar. X transpose X is a scalar. So this is ratio of two scalars. Okay. Now, this particular one, this particular norm, well, even though, as I said, that it's not very convenient for computation, but gives you very nice interpretation. So this one, we showed that we made an additional assumption that matrix A transpose A, this is a symmetric matrix, positive definite matrix. We made one more assumption that A transpose A has linearly independent eigenvalues. So we wrote this matrix A transpose A as psi lambda psi inverse. Actually, what I argued was that since this is a symmetric positive definite matrix, the eigenvectors are orthogonal, so which is same as psi lambda psi transpose, where lambda is a diagonal matrix. With eigenvalues 8 transpose A appearing on diagonal, on main diagonal, and this matrix psi is nothing but matrix formed by keeping eigenvectors of A transpose A next to each other. Okay, so I am just keeping eigenvectors of A next to each other. This is a n cross n matrix, not only invertible, it's a orthonormal matrix, which means psi transpose psi is equal to psi psi transpose is equal to I. Special property of this matrix. Okay. And then I transform this ratio to something very, very interesting. So I wrote this x transpose A x as x transpose psi lambda psi transpose x. Psi psi transpose x, and defining y to be psi transpose x, we wrote this ratio. Defining this new vector, we defined y or we defined z. We defined z. We wrote this ratio. We wrote this ratio to be lambda 1 z1 square plus lambda 2 z2 square plus lambda n zn square. So you can see that this is a ratio of two positive quantities. This ratio of two positive quantities, because eigenvalues of A transpose A are always positive. Okay, eigenvalues of A transpose A are always positive. So because A transpose A is a positive definite matrix, its eigenvalues are positive. Z1 square, Z2 square, whatever is Z, Z1 square, Z2 square is always positive. So this is ratio of two positive quantities. Okay. Now if we order the eigenvalues, as all the eigenvalues are real positive for positive definite matrix, and then if I say that lambda 1 is greater than or equal to lambda 2 is greater than 0. Okay. If this holds, well, there is an implicit assumption when we started all this analysis that A is full rank, that because we are assuming that when you are solving this, we are talking about a full rank matrix. So that's why you get minimum eigenvalue greater than 0. Otherwise, you may have possibility some eigenvalues will be equal to 0. Now, if I number my eigenvalues such that lambda 1 corresponds to the largest. Numbering is depends upon me, what I call 1 and what I call 2. Matrix has eigenvalues, they don't come numbered, we number them. So I am numbering lambda 1 to be the largest. Okay, so it is very easy to see that this ratio will always be less than or equal to lambda 1 z1 square plus lambda 1 z2 square plus lambda 1 zn square upon z1 square up to zn square. Is everyone with me on this? I am just replacing lambda 2 by lambda 1, lambda 3 by lambda 1, lambda 4 by lambda 1. Okay, lambda 1 is the largest magnitude eigenvalue of A transpose A. Okay, so I am allowed to do this. Denominator is same, numerator I am replacing by a larger value for every term by term. Okay. Very easy to see that you can take lambda common. Okay, so this ratio is independent of this is lambda 1. Okay, so this ratio can never exceed lambda 1. This ratio can never exceed lambda 1. Very, very nice property. Okay. What did we start with? We started with this. We wanted to find out maximum of this ratio. What is the maximum of this ratio? Lambda 1. Okay. This ratio can never exceed eigenvalue of maximum magnitude eigenvalue of A transpose A. Okay. So what is 2 norm? What is 2 norm of matrix A? Lambda 1. This is the upper bound, and you can show that this upper bound is attained when eigenvector is aligned in a particular direction. Okay. What happens when x is equal to v1? When will this be an equality? For which direction? V1 transpose A transpose A V1 upon V1 transpose V1. Okay, but V1 can be chosen to be orthonormal. So V1 transpose V1 will be unity. Okay, so this will be V1 transpose lambda 1 V1 upon V1 transpose. Even if it is not chosen orthogonal, even then this ratio will be equal to lambda 1. Okay, so when x is aligned along the direction which corresponds to the eigenvector associated with lambda 1, eigenvector of A transpose A, not eigenvector of A. Eigenvector is defined for a square matrix. Okay. Eigenvector is defined for a square matrix. A transpose A is a square matrix. A in general need not be a square matrix, but A transpose is always a square matrix. So, of course, right now we are dealing with square matrices. We are dealing with square matrices. So, there is no question of non-square matrices. We are dealing with solving AX equal to B where A is square. In fact, we also are have a problem where A is invertible. Otherwise, so this ratio becomes equality when x is aligned along eigenvector of A transpose A. First eigenvector, first in the sense that correspond to the maximum magnitude eigenvalue. So this is equality. Okay, but this ratio for any other x is not equality. Okay, for any other x, this ratio will not be equality. This ratio will be smaller. Okay, that's why the maximum amplification power of a matrix using 2 norm is given by this. Okay. So, I think I have this picture somewhere drawn for a 2-dimensional case. Actually, when you have defined this z is equal to psi transpose x, you have actually defined a transformation which is rotation. Okay, so suppose this is your x y, then this is your z. So this is x1 x2. So this is, let's say this is x1 x2, and this will be your z1 z2 coordinate space. So this is an invertible transformation. You can go from one to other. Okay, so actually you are just rotating your coordinate axis when you are multiplying. Okay, and what happens in the rotated coordinate axis? In the rotated coordinate axis, okay, this x transpose, if you draw this x transpose A transpose A into x, that is, which is same as, okay, if you draw this inside a region where norm x is less than 1. We also had other interpretation of norm, right? You remember we did one more interpretation of norm. Max of A x cap, where x cap is restricted to unit circle. Okay. If you draw that locus of points, then you will see here that this actually corresponds to a ellipse. It actually corresponds to an ellipse. Okay, and these coordinates will be nothing but this will be v1 and this will, sorry, this will be v1. I have drawn anything wrong. The ellipse will be like this. The ellipse will be like this. This z1 will be actually aligned along your direction v1. z2 will be aligned along direction v2. Okay, it will be an ellipse. This ellipse will be major axis will be along the eigenvector corresponds to maximum magnitude eigenvalue. Minor axis will be along the direction which is smallest eigenvalue. All other axes are in between, so that you can. So it will be an ellipsoid in 3 dimension. It will be a ellipsoid in n dimension, depending upon what kind of matrix you are looking at. So I have drawn a picture in somewhere in the. You can have a look at it. But again, the problem with this two norm is you have to find out eigenvalue of A transpose A. If A is large, doesn't help us. Okay, so we could actually come up with a criteria which says that convergence will occur if two norm is nothing but eigenvalue of A transpose A, which is strictly less than 1. But as I said, doesn't really help. So actually, this what we have found here is ratio of the squares. It is square of this by square of this. So what is the two norm? So two norm, it turns out, is square root of lambda 1. That is square root of lambda max of A transpose A. That ratio is for square of, see, this ratio was found for A2 square. Okay, A2 square is equal to lambda 1. So what is A2? Square root of lambda 1. And this will always be positive because A transpose A will always have positive eigenvalues. Okay, so this number will be positive. Okay, in fact, eigenvalues of A transpose A are called as singular values of A, and square root of the maximum magnitude singular value, that is what is what do you expect when A is symmetric? There is a problem in the problem sheet. If A is symmetric, then it will be A transpose is equal to A. So A transpose A will be equal to A square. What is the relationship of eigenvalue of A and A square? Square. It's very easy to show that if lambda is eigenvalue of A, lambda square is eigenvalue of A square. Okay. So if A is symmetric, A transpose A will be, and if A is symmetric positive definite, then it's much easier. A is symmetric positive definite, then it is lambda max of A square. Okay. Lambda max of A square is lambda square of A, and you can deduce for a symmetric positive definite matrix, just look at its eigenvalue, and then you can maximum magnitude eigenvalue will directly give you the norm. But then this norm is again inconvenient because you have to compute eigenvalue. Okay. Now I am going to state two other norms without deriving. The derivations to some extent required for these norms are there in the as a part of your exercises. So you should look at you should try to work out, and then we can see whether you are able to derive that or you end up into some difficulties. I am just going to write these final statements for other norms. Okay, so now even two norm, though it has some nice geometric interpretation, it's not quite convenient for me for computing. So I am going to talk about one norm. So one norm is nothing but max over this. One norm is nothing but max over this. Okay. Well, one small correction. I realized I had made a small mistake here. When I wrote the earlier expression, I'll just correct it. So it is not norm 2 square is equal to this equal to max x not equal to 0. So earlier when I started, I had forgotten this max. Max operator is there. Without max operator, you cannot proceed. And then I have simplified this. I have simplified this quantity. Okay. So moving on to one norm. So this one norm is induced by one norm on the range space and one norm on the domain space. Okay. One norm on the domain space. Maximum of this ratio. Now you can show that one norm. So what is one norm? How do you interpret this? What is this? What is this summation? Is it a column sum or is it a row sum? It's a column sum. So you take all the elements in one column, A11, A21, okay. So 1 is 1, it's summation over 1. So I'm taking summation of mod of each row or each column, okay. So and max over that. So I find out, first of all, I take a matrix which is consisting of only absolute values, only positive numbers. Okay, then I find the column sums. Okay, I find the column sums. Max over the column sum is nothing but this ratio. Max over this ratio. That you can show, it's not very difficult to show this. So, max over column sums, absolute of column sums, that is one norm. And what you can show is infinite norm. So, infinite norm is nothing but max over absolute of row sums. Okay, so these norms you can see here computationally is much more easy to see. What you have to do when you want to compute one norm or infinite norm, you create a matrix A which is A11, A12. You create this matrix which is absolute value of each number. All of them are positive numbers now. Okay. If you take all column sums, find max over it, you will get one norm. Take all row sums, okay, find max of the row sums, that will give you infinite norm. This is much, much easier to compute. One norm or infinite norm are much, much easier to compute. Let's close the... See, this one norm and infinite norm are much, much easier to compute than computing A transpose A and its eigenvalues. No, much more complex business than doing this. This is very, very easy. Okay. So I wanted some easy way of computing norms. Now, where am I going to use this? Okay. Why am I computing norms? Because our condition, necessary and sufficient condition, was spectral radius. Spectral radius is nothing but eigenvalue. Okay. So what is the relationship between norm and eigenvalue? So that is the next part of the puzzle. Is this clear? Now we have three different ways of computing norms. Two norm, one norm, and infinite norm. Among these, one norm and infinite norm are computationally preferable. Okay. And now comes the point is, why am I talking about norms? Yeah? Lambda 1 was nothing but eigenvalue of lambda I. We have this A transpose A VI is equal to lambda I VI. So lambdas are eigenvalues of A transpose A. Okay, now I said that I have numbered the eigenvalues, okay, such that lambda 1 is greater than or equal to lambda 2 is greater than or equal to lambda 3. I have numbered them. Okay. So lambda 1 is nothing but another way of saying lambda 1 is lambda max. Okay. Instead of giving a number and remembering, it's easier to remember this as a formula, lambda max of A transpose. That's why I called it. Okay. Okay, so this theorem which I'm going to state is now the crux of the matter. For any matrix B, any square matrix B, okay, spectral radius, oh sorry, any matrix A, for any matrix A, okay, its spectral radius is always less than or equal to any induced norm. Okay, the spectral radius is always less than or equal to induced norm. So, can you prove this? How will you prove this? What is spectral radius? Spectral radius is spectral radius of A is max over I, or let's use the new notation that we have, lambda max. Spectral radius is nothing but max over this. Right? Now what is induced norm of a matrix? Any induced norm, for any induced norm, is this is true, this is the definition, right? This is the induced norm definition. Okay? So this thing also holds when X corresponds to eigenvector of A. Let's say VI is eigenvector of, okay, VI is equal to lambda I VI, right? So I'm going to write this is equal to norm. So A VI, and if I substitute VI here, this is nothing but lambda I VI right, but what is this quantity? When lambda comes out of the numerator, what happens? Mod lambda I norm VI divided by norm VI, right? Mod lambda I norm VI by norm VI. So this cancels. Okay, what remains is mod lambda I. This holds for every eigenvector. So this also holds for maximum magnitude eigenvector. Right? So this holds for every eigenvector. Okay, which means it also holds for that eigenvector which has a maximum magnitude. Okay, but what is the maximum magnitude eigenvalue? Maximum magnitude eigenvalue is nothing but the spectral radius. Okay. So this inequality, that is mod lambda I is less than or equal to norm A, this holds for all I 1 to n, and this implies that spectral radius of A is less than or equal to norm of A. Everyone with me on this? Okay, so far so good. So now we have developed concept of matrix norms. We have expressions for computing matrix norms. Of course, in MATLAB, if you give a matrix and say give A matrix and say 2 norm, it will give you 2 norm, which is nothing but this. If you say INF infinite norm, it will give you infinite norm, which is nothing but this, and so on. So computing using a software these days for any huge matrix is just very, very simple. Of course, computationally, for a large scale matrix, this is much, much easier. You know, it just has to take absolute sums of rows and find the max. Very, very easy as compared to doing this. But so, and we have a very nice relationship here. Okay, now how I'm going to exploit this? I'm going to use this relationship to come up with sufficient conditions for convergence. Okay, is this all right? We have matrix norms, we know how to compute them, and now we know what is the relationship between the spectral radius and the matrix A, its eigenvalue. We were at one point analyzing behavior of systems of the time z k plus 1, just about two lectures back, b linear difference equations. We are analyzing behavior of this, and we said that if spectral radius of A is strictly less than 1, then what happens? Then norm zk goes to 0 as k tends to infinity. Okay, as k tends to infinity. But spectral radius for a large matrix is difficult to compute. You have to compute eigenvalues. Okay. But from this inequality, what I know is that spectral radius is always less than induced norm. Okay. Now suppose I take A matrix, okay, compute its induced norm. I compute its infinite norm. Okay. Or not A matrix. Here we are talking about, sorry, this should be B matrix here. I'm really sorry. I stand corrected. This should be B matrix here. B should be strictly less than 1. I take my B matrix. Okay. If I take my B matrix, compute its norm, say one norm or infinite norm, and that norm turns out to be less than 1. What can I say about the spectral radius? Right. So if norm of B, say infinite norm, is less than 1, or I am not going to compute two norm, I am going to compute only one norm or infinite norm. So this infinite norm or norm of B, one norm, if this is strictly less than 1, either of them are strictly less than 1. Okay, from this theorem, what I know is that spectral radius of B should be strictly less than 1. Okay, so which means a sufficient condition for convergence of this zk sequence to 0, norm of zk sequence to 0, is that take B matrix, find its one norm or find its infinite norm, if that norm turns out to be less than 1, strictly less than 1, I am done. Okay, I know that zk is going to go to 0 irrespective of what happens to what is your initial condition. It doesn't depend upon what is your z0. Z0 can be large, z0 can be small. Okay, z0 can be arbitrary. I know that if this condition holds, then the spectral radius is always less than 1, because induced norm gives an upper bound on the spectral radius. Induced norm gives upper bound on the spectral radius, and if upper bound is smaller than 1, obviously spectral radius is less than 1, and then okay. So I think we had lot of side stories. Now let me go back to solving AX equal to B. So far so good. Is the line of arguments clear? Okay. So now let's go back and look at what we were doing. Finally we are back to what we wanted. I wanted to solve AX equal to B using an iteration method X K plus 1 is equal to S inverse T X K plus S inverse B. Okay? We have this iteration method. And we said that the error behaves according to Ek plus 1 is equal to S inverse T Ek. Okay, S inverse T Ek. And then we had this condition that spectral radius of S inverse T, now S and T are different depending upon whether it's a Jacobi method or Gauss Seidel method or relaxation method and so on. Now typically S is a simple matrix, S is a diagonal matrix, or S is a lower triangular matrix, and inverting that matrix is not that difficult. Well, we will come up with conditions which even do not require inversion further, but right now even if you want to do it by brute force, by actually inverting S matrix, even then it is not difficult. But now we have this condition, spectral radius less than 1 for error convergence. This is necessary and sufficient condition. This is necessary and sufficient condition. I am now giving you a sufficient condition that if induced norm of S inverse T is strictly less than 1, okay, then spectral radius is less than 1. And why this is just sufficient, why this is not necessary? It can happen that this is greater than 1 and this is less than 1. It can happen. See, this inequality says, it's like saying 0.1 is less than 5 or 0.1 is less than 0.9. Okay, so if you get norm of A to be 5, quite likely that spectral radius of A could be 0.1. You don't know. But if norm of A is 0.9, I surely know that spectral radius of A is less than 1. Okay, if A, norm of A comes out to be 1.1, I cannot say anything about this being less than 1 or this being
than 1. Sorry, if induced norm, okay, typically we'll compute one norm or infinite norm, one norm or infinite norm. If this is less than 1, definitely this is less than 1. Okay, but if this is greater than 1, we cannot say anything about what is this. Okay, inequality just says that this quantity is less than this quantity. We are particularly interested in this number 1, whether this is less than 1. So when this is less than 1, we are sure that this is less than 1. That is the moral of the story. Okay, so I can actually use the norm computation, one norm or infinite norm computations, to come up with a sufficient condition for convergence. Okay, so now let's actually apply this and come up with more practical condition, because I've been talking about 1000 plus 1000 matrix or 10,000 over 10,000 matrix. How do I compute S inverse if it is lower triangular matrix? Computing S inverse is again not a great idea. Okay, I still want a simpler condition. Okay, so what is this going to be? Now I'm going to define a special class of matrices called as diagonally dominant matrices. Okay, I'm going to define a special class of matrices called as diagonally dominant matrices or strictly diagonally dominant matrices. And finding the summation, I am taking a matrix, okay? I am taking summation from j is equal to 1 to n. So I am taking row sum. I am excluding one element from the row sum. Which is that element? The diagonal element. Okay. Now, if mod of the diagonal element, okay, if mod of the diagonal element is strictly greater than some of the remaining elements, absolute sum of the remaining elements. Okay, then, and this should hold for every I. Okay, this is for I equal to 1, 2, n. So if these inequalities hold for each I, then such a matrix is called as diagonally dominant matrix. Such a matrix is called as diagonally dominant matrix. Now, where will it help me? Diagonally dominant matrix. I'll move on here. I hope you have all these in your notebook. Let's go back and see in the Jacobi method what was. We wrote A as S minus T. Okay, for Jacobi method, we had S is equal to, and then we also wrote this that A is equal to L plus D plus U. Then for Jacobi method, S was D and T was L plus U, minus of L plus U. Okay, minus of L plus U. Now, just think of this S inverse T, which is minus D inverse L plus U. What is D inverse? D is a diagonal matrix. All the elements, inverse is just one upon diagonal elements. Okay. Now, if matrix A is diagonally dominant, okay, then what happens? Aii are all greater than the summation of all the row elements, absolute of row elements. What is this matrix? Can you just write down? What is this matrix? For Jacobi method, S inverse T will be, what will be this matrix? 0 minus A12 by A11 minus A13 by A11 minus A1n by A11 minus A21 by A22 0 minus A23 by A22 minus A2n by A22, right? This S inverse T will be a matrix which has 0 on the diagonal. All diagonal elements will be like this. What will be its infinite norm?
Row sum.
Row sum will be nothing but, what will be each row sum? Summation Aij, j going from 1 to n divided by Aii. Aii is dividing each row. Just look at here. Okay, but this is a diagonally dominant matrix, which means this sum is strictly less than, right? This sum is strictly less than this. If this sum is strictly less than this, what does it mean? That all these ratios are strictly less than 1. What does it mean? Infinite norm is strictly less than 1. If infinite norm is strictly less than 1, what can you say about the spectral radius of this matrix? Okay, so now I have reduced checking whether Jacobi method will converge or not, just to see whether A matrix, whether it is diagonally dominant or not. If matrix A is diagonally dominant, okay, my iterations will converge irrespective of where I start from. Okay, irrespective of where I start from, my iterations will converge if my matrix A is diagonally dominant. So after doing all this Jacobi, lot of arguments, learning about, you know, matrix norms and then the spectral radius, all that, we have come up with a very simple criteria for finding out whether Jacobi iterations will converge or not. I'll give you some more theorems I will not get into the proofs of each one of them. My proofs are given in the appendix. But I will give you some more theorems which are very elegant and from which you can ascertain whether your iterations will converge or not. Or you can modify your problem such that the iterations are guaranteed to converge. Okay, so that's what we'll see next class briefly and then move on to some other analysis. But this is where you can see, you know, eigenvalues, spectral radius, and norms, everything in action. We are using it to analyze the behavior qualitatively without actually having to solve it. Just looking at diagonal dominance, I can come to the conclusion for any initial guess, my iterations will converge. Okay, very, very nice result, very, very powerful.